I can't tell you how meaningful, emotional, and weird this is. Because you see, when I was in my 20s, I wanted to be Joan. I was obsessed with her. Everything I read about her, she could walk around with bare feet, which I couldn't do. Everything she had was in a duffel bag. She was a gypsy, and then there was the voice. I wanted to be her. And our paths crossed from time to time, but we never were friends.
It's not too late.
We have some of the same issues, which I didn't know until I saw this documentary. And, you know, women are not supposed to tell their truth. And when they do, it's universal. And thank you for being so brave.
Thanks,
because
Jane.
This is so universal, and I'm just honored to I'm getting to know her. I'm so happy.
We just cry all the time with our new friendship. Brings a lot of tears.
How much did Joan control what was in the film or not in the film? I don't know which of the three of you I should address that to.
She did not control very much.
Anything.
Okay, so she just opened the archives and there you went.
We started out thinking we were doing something different. So at the beginning, we thought we were going to follow her on her final tour.
Uh-huh.
And more of a verite film, not so deep inside her life. And then we stumbled upon her archive.
So you had started, or you were planning to start it before you knew about the archives.
Yeah, we started a while ago, as some cameramen can attest, kind of filming, trying to figure out what the film was. And Karen had a close friendship with her. So Karen had wanted to do a film for a long time. We just didn't know exactly what we were going to do.
That's remarkable.
But it was a big act of trust.
It was
total trust. And in the film, when I walk into that storage unit, it's the first time I've ever been in the storage unit. So yeah. So I thought there would be lampshades and bedsteads, but instead it was my entire life, which my mom had kept all of that stuff that you saw, and I haven't seen most of it. Big surprises for me watching the film. Yeah.
I am so happy that your drawings are in this documentary. I don't know how many of you have read Joan's book called Am I Pretty When I Fly? You must, if you haven't. It's just glorious. The drawings are so wonderful. And in the book, what you learn is that she does most of them upside down.
Not me standing on my head, just the paper there.
And Tell me why you do that?
I never really figured it out. But I knew, Jane, that if I draw these things upside down, something deeper than would otherwise happen if I was doing it right side up. It crosses some synapses or does something, and it allows things otherwise unavailable to me to come out on the page.
It's just so great,
Thank you.
The trick in life is to get old without ever growing up. Do you know
Yay.
What I mean? And what I love so much about the drawings, and why I was so happy to see them in the movie, is because you haven't grown up.
Whoopee!
It's so playful and everything. And who had the idea of animating them?
I think initially Miri and I were really, they were jumping off the page, and we were both, felt that we would love to animate them. Karen was a little bit more pensive at the beginning, and so there was kind of a back and forth, and ultimately we just felt like it was worth, trying, and we got the Eat the Danger guys involved, and they were so incredibly talented, and they also had a kind of dark and light kind of approach, which was really what we wanted. They captured Joan's kind of both her darkness but also her sense of humor.
That's for sure.
What I mean? And so it was just, they also, we regularly use the word artifact. We wanted it to be so close to what Joan created, and they completely honored that and just just brought them to life, but kept them very, very close to Joan's originals.
So brilliant, great.
And the art was always a huge part of the overall kind of look and feel of the film, the artwork. Everything in the film had, we have a trajectory of Joan's art from 5 years on all the way. And so we thought if we could use the art in a kind of three-part structure as well as the audio tapes and everything else, so it became just really helpful in terms of how to structure the film, and then just having this extraordinary original art all the way through was part of that gold mine.
Joan, why did you want to do this documentary, and why now?
Well, now because in a few years it might be too late, I don't know yet, but Karen and I talked about it on and off over the years, and then it got closer to ending the career, so maybe that'd be a good idea to capture that. With the thought in mind that even if I changed my mind, it would be an interesting point in my life to figure out what I would be doing. If I say, yeah, maybe I'm not ready to give this up, what would that mean? But I was ready to give it up, but I have not regretted that for one split second. I really haven't. It's been wonderful. The other things are my family was all gone. I couldn't have done that in depth the way I did if my family were still here, my immediate family. And why I wanted to do what we refer to as an honest legacy. Just, I've got nothing to lose. You know, at my age and the stuff I've done my whole life, nothing is any more outrageous than this. So I thought it would certainly be beneficial to me and perhaps to other people to just be honest about this funny life I've had.
You wanted to, in a way, to speak to other survivors?
Well, I wanted to speak to people in general, but yes, people who'd had severe traumas, childhood and otherwise, all relate to other people's traumas. And I thought for some of the people who are afraid to speak up for themselves because they might not be believed or understood, if I did that, it might be helpful to that pool of survivors, yeah.
We've also found in the experience, we've done a festival run, and that people everywhere of all ages, men and women, have related to Joan's kind of experience. It doesn't have to be identical, but everybody has something. And so the idea that somebody famous has been so direct and candid about her own inner struggles, I think, has been moving to people.
I think it can inspire people because not everybody has the courage. If they have a life that's neurotic and chaotic and difficult the way yours was, although who would have known? I mean, I was just stunned because I always thought, well, she has it all together. She know. Look how happy she is, that glorious smile she always has, you know. So it's wonderful that you have revealed this. Did the making of it change you? Did you learn from it?
I learned a lot from watching it, yeah. I mean, there are things I either didn't know about at all or had forgotten
such
as the letter from the psychiatrist saying Joni has psychological problems. Oh. Never seen that or don't remember seeing it. The tape from my father saying goodbye is absolutely heart-wrenching to me, and important that he has his say. And I always want to repeat, because it's hard for people to understand, that my parents did not remember this stuff. It just is the block is so phenomenal, and denial. Denial is your friend. You know, denial keeps you from having to deal some of this with some of this. And so that's what's heartbreaking, is that I knew that, and I didn't blame them. I just had to deal with it, you know.
And your sisters.
Yeah, and my sisters, the same. They've never been able to really say to me how they really felt, you know? You kind of water it down because she's your sister. And then Karen really had their trust also, especially Pauline, who would never talk to anybody, never have a camera around. And here she was saying, you know, I couldn't deal with it. This is how I dealt with my sister. I had to leave. No, so to hear them being direct was really important for me. And also my lovely son. I thought he was so generous and thoughtful and forgiving when he's talking about which was a childhood of I mean, I saw more in the film, but he hasn't been able to express the depth of how he felt, the abandonment. So, yeah, it's not particularly easy for me to watch the film. I
definitely want my kids to watch this.
Well,
her son forgave her. So I'm waiting. But, you know, this is the first... I saw the film twice already, but on a computer screen without my hearing aids. And it was it was tonight that I understood a lot of it that I hadn't quite gotten before. And I never, ever have heard about perpetrators not remembering.
Oh, yeah.
That is fascinating to me.
Oh, yes. I think way more... I mean, because we can't imagine... them not remembering, and because it's a place to put the blame. But I think if you think about it, it took me a half a century to do this journey because I had blocked everything was in the subconscious and the unconscious. So my parents didn't want to deal with it, you know, and that denial would save their lives, really.
Yeah. Wow.
That's one to think about.
Yeah. I'd like to ask if any of you have, I'm sure that many of you have questions.
Questions, but no stories.
Folks, if you have a question, give me a wave. I'll come around.
Hi. Thank you all so much. This was beautiful. I wanted to ask, as a burgeoning therapist and somebody who's also starting parts work, what is at the core of what works? What helps?
What makes you get better?
Yeah.
Well, one is it's for the therapist and the person is tremendous amount of work and listening and insight. And I don't know what your techniques will be, but you'll probably be challenged by other people saying that they won't work. And then you have to just, you know, go ahead partly on your instinct of what you think is working with that person. And I wish you luck.
We have another one right here.
Hi, Joan. I'm a big fan. Your covers are so soulful. I was curious, what's the special quality about a song that attracts you to it enough to want to honor it with a cover?
Oh, just, I never know. The song, I don't pick the song. It kind of does pick me. It sounds a little corny, but that's true. So whatever they were, it was something that spoke to me and I followed through.
We have a question in the front right here.
Ms. Baez, I remember back in 1979, you published an ad criticizing the Viet Cong government for its treatment of the Vietnamese people. Did any of the people who declined to sign your petition express any remorse about not signing it?
That doesn't have too much to do with the film, but the letter that I wrote way, way back accusing the Viet Cong of torture was not popular with the left. And we let it go at that. I haven't been waiting around for big apologies. I just said what I needed to say. Thanks.
I have a question back here.
Yeah, hi. This is a question for the filmmakers. What was the most difficult part of doing this film?
How much time do you have?
I'll start and you can take it. I think it was really, there were many, many different layers of stories in this film. There were multiple layers that were super duper complicated. It was, Joan's lived an incredibly amazing, complicated, deep, layered life. And so we wanted to tell, you know, and really, you know, savor all the kind of artistic endeavors, her musicality, her history, her civil rights, all of that stuff, her politics, and then also interweave the psychological layer in there too. And I suppose one of the biggest challenges I'll say for myself as an editor as well is just not to allow the psychological trauma to have context and nuance and for it not to overshadow kind of the other layers of the story, so that, you know, we really had a joyous kind of overall arc of the film, you know, from beginning to end. You can.
Yeah, I'll just add on, like, the massiveness of her archive was, for me, the most difficult. And from the journals to the meticulously kept hundreds and thousands of letters that her family wrote back and forth to each other, to the artwork that spanned, 70 years, and she was quite prolific and kept everything. For me, kind of teasing through all of that, and then also bringing her whole family to life was really difficult. We had no talking heads. We had that interview with Pauline, but everybody had died, and everybody had a different story than Joan had, and we felt like it was important to have their viewpoint in the film, as difficult as that might have been for Joan. And so trying to realize those different stories, I think, was quite difficult.
Another question in the back here.
Good evening. A question for Joan. After the very fast and intense relationship you had with Bob Dylan, did you ever cross paths again in your life? Either
no evening goes by without that question.
After
Rolling Thunder, not a whole lot of activity with Bob.
Who's asking the next question after that one?
You imitate him brilliantly, by the way. That is so great when you do that.
Hi. This question is for Joan and all the amazing women. Hi. On stage, how do you deal with imposter syndrome? That's something that was brought up in the film.
Imposter.
Or inferiority. Feeling
imposter
like you're inferior.
Do I know what that means?
Imposter syndrome right now with these two legends on stage. It's basically feeling less than,
Do you understand any more than I do?
Imposter syndrome. Why would you even assume that she ever knew what that was?
Oh, just the part, in the beginning of the film, when you're kind of just starting out in your career and you kind of discussed feelings of inferiority. So, yeah.
That I can deal with. Imposter, I don't understand. And did I have them? And why did I have them? It kind of explains it in the film. But how I managed to push through that, I'm not really sure. I do know that much as I was bored with Quaker meeting, I did retain the silence and the meditative work from that. And that would be one of the answers to your question of how I, quote, held it together as it fell apart.
Another one right here.
Hi. There were so many wonderful elements to this film, the music, the interviews, the incredible visuals. But I just want to say that Joan's sense of humor just shone through and punctuated the film in all these wonderful little moments. So thank you for that, and thank you for recognizing it.
Thank you.
In the film. I did want to ask, when you make a film and you're it's an immersive film and you follow people around and you ask them incredibly intimate, sensitive questions. It's very different than the normal social construct that you have. And I wondered if there were any moments, Joan, when you felt like, wait, this is too much, or...
Felt like throttling them? Yes, I always come back to the same one because it's sort of funny. I did not want to do the vocalizing because it's embarrassing and stupid and sounds awful. And they would say, oh, but it's so interesting. I say, I don't give a fuck if it's interesting or not. It's ugly and stupid. I sound horrible. And then a cave. And the reason I would cave was that innately I knew that their choices are what would make a brilliant film. And so I put up with it.
Jane, we're going to take one more in the back before you wrap up with this wonderful panel. One more question from the audience before Jane wraps.
Thank you very much. Just a quick shout out to the editing is extraordinary in this film.
Yay.
I mean,
thank you.
And of course, a part of the editing, the entire storytelling and everything like that is amazing. It's been an honor to be able to see the film. A question for you, Joan, which is, as I mentioned, you saved so much. Your archive is so meticulous and all that. And I'm wondering, what do you think, what was the impulse in your keeping all those things so precious throughout your entire life, so many of them?
Well, I think it's time to let them go. There's something about, you know, I mean, you saw multiple personalities and all my little people and everything. Not everybody's ready to have a bonfire with all the tapes that are remaining. But I think that's the smart thing to do, is bless it and let it all go.
And with that, congratulations, Miri, Maeve, Karen. It's just the most unusual and wonderful and like gold, as the New York Times said. And thank you for giving us this gift, Joan.
And thank you, Jane Fonda. I can't tell you how wonderful it was to have you with us here tonight. It means everything. So thank you so much.
Great. And read her book, Am I Pretty When I Fly?